once again, ladies and gentlemen. It's an honor to have with us Ms. Arpana Caur as our guest artist for the evening. It is also a privilege to have with us our finance secretary, Mr. Sarabjit Singh. At the outset, may I request Sri B. Malhotra, the chairman of the Chandigarh Lalit Kala Academy, to kindly welcome Mr. Sarabjit Singh, the chief guest for the evening, with a bouquet. May I request our vice chairman, Sri Madan Lal, to kindly welcome the artist, Ms. Arpana Caur, and her husband, Sri Harinder Singh, who is also with us today. We welcome you, ma'am. A bouquet for Sri Harinder Singh. I would request Mr. Ram Pratap, the secretary of the Chandigarh Lalit Kala Academy, to welcome Professor B.N. Goswami. Many of us here would be having in our mental treasure trove of paintings one of Arpana Caur's, perhaps one of Guru Nanak's, or of a Sufi saint, or even of the legendary Sohni. Their vibrant colors, vivid flowing forms, and pointed narrative permanently etched in our minds. Arpana Caur grew up in Punjab in the early 50s, at a time when the wounds of partition were still raw. Her formative years were marked by impressions of her grandfather tending to the poor and of her mother distributing alms to the destitute. The atmosphere in the Sikh household would have been imbued with the spirit of piety, which became the bedrock from which her creative energies were to gain their sustenance. Her mother's stature as a renowned Punjabi writer and her own studies in literature fueled her poetic idiom further. Largely a self-taught artist, Arpana Caur began exhibiting her paintings from 1974 onwards, not just in India's mega cities, but also across the globe, in galleries in London, Glasgow, Berlin, Amsterdam, Singapore, Munich, New York, and in Stockholm and the Copenhagen National Museum. Her works grace the museums of modern art in Delhi, Mumbai, Chennai, Jaipur, Bhopal, Dusseldorf, Singapore, the Peabody Boston, the Asian Art Museum in San Francisco, the Victoria and Albert Museum, London, and even our museum next door. She has been extensively written about and filmed and awarded, including a gold medal at the 6th International Triennial 1986 in New Delhi. Ms. Caur's oeuvre ranges from nuanced reflections on spirituality, time, life, and death, to a spirited concern for the environment, a feminist perspective, and anguish at the increasing violence in the world. She was commissioned by the Hiroshima Museum of Modern Art to execute a large work for its permanent collection for the 50th anniversary of the Holocaust in 1995. And has also done large non-commercial murals in Delhi, Bangalore, Kathmandu, and Hamburg. The striking backgrounds of her canvases, aglow with the ochre tones of piety, or blazing a brilliant red, and sometimes a starkly somber black, are offset by the metaphorical figures and images that stand out, articulating the spectrum of human emotions and informed by critical analytical stance. Her modern idiom is rooted in the language of ancient Indian sculptures and miniatures. Ms. Caur uses her brush not only to usher in social change through the themes she portrays, but also to support the underprivileged through free vocational training in the Academy of Fine Arts and Literature that she has founded along with her mother. She also supports a leprosy home in Ghaziabad and ration projects for poor and old widows through the Om Waheguru Ashram. It is indeed an honor to have you with us, ma'am, and we now await your presentation. Thank you.
I would like to say a great thanks to Lalit Kala Academy for calling me to this very beautiful city several times and my own misfortune, I could not come earlier. For me, the city is absolute contrast to Delhi, where I come from, and I envy you people for living in this city with its very wide arteries, its lake, and its two beautiful museums. It was the first city in India to have two museums. And for me, this city is also two people, Dr. Goswami, who is a gem and pride of this city. It makes me very nervous that he's sitting in front of me as I speak, because I've heard and attended a lot of his presentations and feel like a perfect novice. And the other, of course, is the late Nekchand. Also, Dr. M.S. Randhawa, who bequeathed the two museums to this city and its many beautiful trees. So it's a great privilege and honor, and thank you for having me. I will start with talking very quickly, because I have too many works to share. It's a 40-year journey, and I was given a time slot of an hour. If I'm going too fast, please ask me to slow down, because even at the age of 61, my mother rings up an hour before every slide presentation and says, "Don't rush through your slide presentation." And I always tell her, you know, I'm afraid that I'll be boring people if I go on and on. She says, "No, you have to listen and slow down." So I'll try to do a medium of both and start with my three inspirations, our old sculpture tradition, our miniatures. This particular one is in our collection. When I started doing well, I of course started buying books of miniatures when my work began to sell, and then the originals in the boom period of Indian art. So the way women buy jewelry and clothes, I would buy a miniature, and sometimes even exchange my own paintings with people who had these. So we have about 250, and my mother set up a free museum of these in Delhi. They're all registered with ASI, and it's open to the public every day. And folk art traditions, which are very much alive in our country, so my main sources of inspiration. Painting done at the age of 9, which my mother has lovingly preserved. Mother and daughter, you can recognize, is from Amrita Shergill's Hill Women. My mother did not give me a sick name. Being a writer, she's a kind of iconoclast. And she felt that, you know, a name brands you with the religion. So she said, "You choose your own name when you have to fill your school leaving certificate." I was in Simla, I was 15, I chose the name Arpana. Before that, and my first choice was Amrita. But I thought, you know, I'll make a laughing stock of myself, calling myself after such a great painter. So this, at the age of 9, very frayed, but she has it still, Hill Women. Sheltered Woman, which is also in Chandigarh. And Dr. Randhawa had picked it up for the museum for a princely sum of 5,000 rupees. It's a 6 by 5 foot oil on canvas. I used to be very sort of disturbed, and still am, by the great socio-economic disparities in our country. And this umbrella is a symbol of shelter, and the many unsheltered against the one sheltered. Missing audience, because there was no audience for art. We had just two galleries in Delhi when I began to show, not even two lines in the newspaper. So I did this whole series called Missing Audience, in which the poor man has to listen to himself. There's nobody listening to him. I'm very delighted with the full house today. Thank you. Then comes 1984 genocide, which was a very tragic series for me, because I had worked in the relief camps with my mother for several years, right from the second day, and drove through the murderous mobs to reach across to people. With whatever little we had, we would load in our car in Tempo and take to the relief camps. And I didn't want to pain death, but I had to wash it out of my system. And Mr. Al-Ghazi was gracious enough to show this series in his gallery in Delhi in Art Heritage in 1985. and then send it to Bombay to Simrosa Gallery and to Calcutta in 1986. World goes on. I'm showing you very few of each series so that we can condense it. And I didn't know how to paint death. So I thought, if I do a drowning figure, and the Basoli miniatures came to my rescue, because to paint tragedy and pain, you need a kind of relief as well. If Krishanji is laying Putna's head and there's blood gushing out, it's done in a very quiet, highly beautiful aesthetic manner, unlike Western expressionist art. So that kind of taught me to paint the pain in a beautiful way so that I could give myself some relief. And the canvases are all, this particular ones, for instance, 7 feet by 5, and Doxa will recognize the curved horizon line of Pasoli. World goes on. This was in the Trinale and won the gold medal. It was to come to Chandigarh, but now is in Delhi National Gallery. So each figure, you can see, is organic, and the way it's painted is very much as we do in our miniature painting or our sculpture tradition, very organic. And the figure right on top is a kite flyer. This is in NJM in Delhi, and a corresponding painting done in the same year was also graciously picked up by Dr. Goswami for Chandigarh Museum. It's called Juggler, not the same subject, but roughly the same period, 5 by 6 feet. I went to see it today. It was in storage. World goes on. But they have a beautiful painting on display, Water Weaver. I discovered to my horror that I've neither signed it on the front nor back. So I promised to go tomorrow and see if I can sign it, because the painter goes up there and the painting remains, so it ought to have a signature at least. World goes on, the same series. The mountain forms you'll recognize are from our miniature tradition as well, and the dead figure is from a woman on a charpai, and which has a very strange perspective. Amrita has taken the woman from top and the rest sitting around her from a frontal perspective. It's a very, very poor reproduction, but I shot it from the log of the Hiroshima Museum, because those times one didn't have money for a camera. Money for canvas and paints was itself a luxury. So the painting is in Hiroshima, and I got a letter, Mr. Arpana Caur, not me, got a letter saying that it's the 50th year of the bombing. My work had gone in 1982 through National Gallery to some group show in one or two museums in Japan, and been written about. So they didn't know whether it's a man or a woman. So I get this letter saying we are commissioning 10 artists. It's the 50th year of the bombing. The sum offered was really huge. And I didn't dare correct them, because all the 9 other names were male names, like Anthony Green, Sam Francis, Nimjun Paik, etc. So one of my friends who'd gone there on a scholarship, Anupam Sood, said it's a slightly tilted scenario, so, women-wise. So I thought, and I was desperate to be in Hiroshima Museum, because as a child, somehow my mother had taught me to close my eyes for 2 minutes on 6th August and 9th August. And I still do. I started doing it when I was 7 or 8 and still do. So I thought I'll do this triptych and break it up with primary colors, not have a continuation of color and form. In fact, I did this for several paintings, triptychs and diptychs, where I thought, okay, let me not have the Max Beckmann-like continuity of color and form, and try to break it up and see if it still holds together as a painting, and have these little links like this. The lotus stem turning into the stern of the gun. Just these little links. And I enjoyed the 3-4 years that I did this triptych kind of experiment. And typically, Delhi Customs held it up. They let all the antiques through, and they said that, ye to wo hai, purani painting hai. I said, nahin ji, meri hai, and it took a lot of struggle to get this painting through. But when I finally reached Hiroshima, I mean, they got a big surprise that the person who stepped out of the plane, because they kindly invited me when it was installed on 6th August 1995 in that museum. This is another painting related to violence. It came much later. It's the destruction of the Bamiyan Buddha, and again shot from a catalogue. The shadow of the Buddha remains in the tomb. When I went to Hiroshima, I saw this bomb dome, and I said to myself, I was invited to Germany to do an installation. It was an exhibition near Frankfurt. So I said, okay, as a painter, I want at least one permanent element in an installation. Nothing is permanent, but then you have the sort of illusion that, okay, painting would be permanent. So I did this bomb dome against a background of Madhubani birds and animals, and it was a 6-foot canvas. They gave me a 20-foot wall. I painted the tears and the scale on the wall, and the ghadas went from here, not one broke. Although 5 were terracotta, and I was very afraid, and 5 were brass. And then the same installation was done in Bombay, in Simrosa, and in Seema Gallery, Calcutta, and finally Delhi. Tears for Hiroshima. So the ghadas were filled with water. A chance visit to Vrindavan in 1987 with a group of artists and Harinder led to... I had gone to Mathura Museum to see the marvelous sculpture collection. And we landed up in Vrindavan also, and one associated it with the place of romance. I was being courted those days. So we went to Radha Kunj. And what I saw instead in Vrindavan was a reversal of the myth. So instead of the gopis, you have these shaven widows, mostly from Bengal. And it was indescribable because I was not aware, this was 1987, that there are thousands of widows who live on half a katori of rice and 8 annas a day for chanting 8 hours a day. And Radha Kunj had these twisted trees, which seemed like the forms of these women, and as if Krishna had turned his back on them. So I did this whole series when I came back, Widows of Vrindavan, which also Mr. Al-Ghazi showed in 1988 in Art Heritage. Mrs. Al-Ghazi was always shouting at me and saying, what's a nice young girl like you doing? You know, the 84 genocide series, Widows of Vrindavan. And I said, Mrs. Al-Ghazi, I see these things. What should I do? Because these are not, as you know, sellable works. Out of this also, because I went to Varanasi after that, and I started this Kabir series. Kabir weaving water. Sun samad mein bunat hamari, hamra jhagra rahana ko, kazi mulla bisral do. So he's weaving in the great eternity. And he's weaving water for harmony. Our times are, as you know, very turbulent, and Dr. Goswami will recognize where the water is from at the back. And there's another triptych, Body is Just a Garment. This was the beginning of this series of 33 works and some terracotta sculptures. Body is Just a Garment. And I was thinking of all the women saints like Laldei and, you know, everyone else who went around Amal like this in the world. This is his birthplace in Varanasi, which is still as magical as it was 500 years ago, as unspoiled. The pond that you see is where Nero and Nima found him, the same series. And I imagine the maker making all of us the garments. And he looked like my grandfather. The multiple figures are, of course, our special tradition which we inherited. And, you know, normally you see them in horse or elephant figure. And I kind of thought I should adapt it to human form like this, and I did many times. In 1997, India turned 50, and I thought I must remember people of that time, like my grandfather who brought the Guru Granth Sahib on his head, which we still read every day. It's the same Granth Sahib, and he brought a bundle of memories on his back, and I painted these Madhubani lions. It's 6-foot canvas behind him because the partition happened while they were holidaying, as they always did every year in Simla or Kashmir. And his parents and my grandmother's old parents were left back in Lahore. So he thought he must get them out and must get the Granth Sahib. And Kushwant Singh's uncle was his dear friend. He said, if you're going to die, I'll die with you. So both the old men crossed the border, and they were helped by a Muslim doctor, because he was a doctor and they were on Chamberlain Road, which was a doctor's road. They managed to get these old, four old people out of the house and the Granth Sahib. So it was a fascinating story. And I wanted to remember him that particular year when we turned 50. Bhagat Singh and the Basanti Chola. That's a very poor reproduction, but that's my problem also, that a lot of paintings that are not with me have had to be shot from books. I know the technology is now there to rectify the colors, and I promise myself every time I do a laptop that I will rectify the colors, and then painting seems more important than sitting with somebody on a computer and rectifying colors. And then when I see them in a laptop, I say, Arpana, you have to do it someday. So this is day and night my favorite subject. I've never seen anybody painting day and night, so I said, well, this happens every day, and it's about time, and it's about life and death. I want to paint time. And I want time to go slowly, because you want to be around forever, and of course it's not possible. So I wrote this time goes slow on the painting. Also, I like writing sometimes on the painting, because it creates a kind of visual duality with the organic figures. So it's 16 years of painting scissors. Harinder is sick of my scissors. Satish Gujral calls me Kenchi, and I haven't got it out of my system yet. There's one on the poster also, the day and night. So I do these repeated figures, and I purposely chose a female figure as night, because if I had chosen a male figure, it would have been a feminist painting. No, within day is night, and the same female figures. Poor reproductions, but I want to share them with you. And the Varli circle of the dancing figures from the Varli folk art. These are 9-foot canvases. And I've used a spray for day, because I wanted the effulgence of day. Endless journeys in which I've used two folk elements also. There's Jangar Singh's plane, who went to Japan and never came back, as you know. He hung himself, unfortunately, so I wanted to include his plane, which is in my collection, and the very surprised Madhubani head in the middle, and the Varli figures, of course, the dance. It's a 9-foot painting that was in the recent Beijing Biennale. River of Time, with the multiple figures again. Yogi and the River of Time. Time is really a huge fascination with me. This is in National Gallery, Delhi, and it was done about 15 years back, where the Varli elements that you see at the back of harvest, which we are the harvest, and the green nature who makes us and cuts us unaware at the same time. This is where it's wrong. And I also wanted to do it in the context of time. So when you throw a pebble in a pond, it creates ripples. So these are painting within painting, like ripples of time. The Varli circle of the dance of life has been broken again with these ripples and painting within painting. Sometimes, myth acts as a springboard. The myths we've grown up with, Sita was a daughter of the earth, and she eventually went into the earth, and somebody painted a circle to protect her, but now she's having to paint her own green line to protect herself. So this whole series was called Green Circle. Kalpavriksh, Tree of Desire. It's a 10-by-6-foot diptych. I did 2 or 3, and I wanted to paint this inverted tree. This was about 25 years back. I could not find a painted reference. Later I'll have a word with Sir and ask him if he knows of one. I went to Kapilaji and asked her if she'd ever seen a painted Kalpavriksh, because I'd read about it in Kathopnishad and Gita and wanted to paint it. She said, I can't remember, but there is a low relief sculpture I've seen somewhere. So I said, okay, let me paint this Kalpavriksh, and it's the Tree of Desire in the context of age and youth, as well as the tight urban DDA-like houses we live in Delhi, and the longing for space. So it works on two levels, environment as well as this youth age thing. So I did a few of these Kalpavriksh, and I was very happy. Then we went to Jaisalmer for a holiday about 20 years ago. We went to Ludarwa which is 40 kilometers away, the old kingdom, all buried in the sand except for one surviving Jain temple and, would you believe it, a 10 or 12 foot metal kalpavriksh, 10 centuries old, 10 centuries standing by itself in the desert. So I said, I started crying with joy and said, I've come here and, you know, to find you. This is what, you know, W.B. Yeats had a word for it called racial unconscious. All these things flow in our veins. Dharti, who's longing for a better, and that tree that you see on our arm is from a Varli painting as well. These are environmental works. Renewal, this one is called. Dharti. Living in a city like Delhi, you have to paint many dhartis. Like this Nayaka stepping out of that walled space into, you know, green and blue. The Mewar miniatures at the back. And I love the posture of the Nayaka always and want to abstract the figure so that you just have the bare essentials of her in movement like a dancer stepping out. Prayer for trees. This is a mural I did in Bangalore. There was an IS officer who saw my Delhi mural done in 2000, free of cost. And she said, I can give you the best five walls in Bangalore. We have no money. So, typical officer she was. So I said, okay, let me see the walls. So she said, I'll give you an air ticket to come and see the walls and an air ticket to paint the murals and no money. I said, okay, first let me see the walls. So she sent me this ticket and I fell in love with the walls. One was the outer wall of Heber Rurik Museum, which is in a very busy area of Bangalore. The other was a Kantivaram Stadium where thousands of people go. The third was an indoor stadium near the airport on an 88-foot road. And a lot of musical recitals happen like Jasraj and all. So I said, okay, now this work, because how many people come to art galleries, you know? Maybe that's why many cities don't have art galleries. And that's one thing I've always felt sad about, even Punjab, that, you know, it needs a vibrant art gallery culture to sustain the artists, instead of artists of my generation all migrated away to Delhi and Bombay. We know that. So every city needs a very vibrant, of course, this Lalit Kala has become very, very vibrant in the last few years here. But to have this, you know, sustaining its artists, you need private galleries as well. So I don't know where I started. I've lost the thread, but that's the story of the mural in Bangalore. It's the outer wall of Heber Rurik Museum. And those walls that you see around are traffic because that's a very busy road on which this museum is. This is the one I did in Delhi. On the wall of my old school, which was a free school for girls, almost free with a very high standard of education, I wanted to, in a way, thank the school. I did it 15 years back. And there's a German artist who wanted to work with me, so we did this collaboratively. It's a map of the world where we are putting 52 puzzle parts, and each has elements of nature and industry. And to say that not one is the evil, but how to balance them, marry the two together. Then he invited me to Hamburg. Again, he said, we are a group of artists. We want to work with artists of another culture. We have no money. We'll give you an air ticket and a place to stay near the wall. I said, okay. But this time, because they drove me around Hamburg and I saw a lot of gray and brown murals. So I said, okay, I want a very bright, Indian red background and the goddess on a lotus, and let's have time as the theme, because you people measure everything with scales and compasses. We are timeless. So I did this goddess on a lotus and the charkha and a kundalini and a pot containing water, and Zwinke did the industrial elements of Hamburg, and I said, let's link it with this Varli circle of the dance of life. And I believe it's as fresh as it was yesterday, although it's a great height. It's the third, fourth, fifth story of a building, and my legs shook like jelly the first few days. But the scaffolding is very, very sturdy. I really envy their scaffolding, which we don't have here. So that's me on the scaffolding. I could have my lunch, lie down, because I work like 16 hours a day. This is a thermal power station near my house, which is a 14th century monument called Siri Fort. And it has all these dualities of the monument, the thermal power station, the women of Shapur Jat, which is also a very fashionable boutique place. Still, the women dry dung cakes on the walls of this thermal power station. And, you know, these kind of dualities are so fascinating that sometimes on the highway to Ghaziabad, to Om Vaheguru Rishi Ashram, which was mentioned earlier, every Sunday, I see, for instance, a bullock cart carrying the upper body of an automobile. So I said, how to bring that out? This was about 20 years back. I thought I'll collaborate with a folk artist, Satnarayan Pandey, and we did some works together. And for the first time, he, a folk artist and a contemporary artist, co-signed. And I had this kind of traveling show. Between Dualities was the name of the show. These are paper works when, before the Commonwealth Games, a forest was cut near my house and the peacocks were eaten by stray dogs. I not only went to the court with my mother and Harinder and two, three other people. People don't have time to fight cases like that. But we fought a case against Delhi government for 15 months, won the case, and instead of giving it to restaurants and food courts, trees are beginning to be replanted there. So this paperwork is called Ghost, and that's a real peacock feather because the peacocks were devoured by stray dogs. And I sent some to the Jain Bird Hospital in Old Delhi also. Dharti, this was done at the same time with this urban architecture. I come to the Sony series, which I showed about 15 years ago. And there is the arrow, that the love arrow, and that Cupid at the bottom right from Udaipur, and the Mewar miniature of the hunt. So there is a kind of arrow that kills and a kind of arrow that pleasurably wounds, you know, the love arrow. 7-foot canvases for the space, and I've used the plug as a little tongue-in-cheek, you know, connection that in the Sufi tradition, love connects you to God, you know, ishq, hakiki ishq, mazazi, become one. And you know, I also try to contemporize the myth. And she's not a myth, by the way. Sonia was a real woman, born in Akhnoor 500 years ago. I was desperate to visit her birthplace, and I did. I was desperate to stand in the same chenab, I did. And again, you know, wept that I had been able to come there with all the bullets flying both sides. She fell in love. So here, literally, I've made her fall in love. It's an 8-foot painting called Love Beyond Measure, because her life was cut short, hence the scissor, the splash of the water in the blue. And I like to use color with an element of surprise, you know, so the little blue and the rest is all black. Love Beyond Measure. The posture you can see is from this painting I found in Dr. Goswami's book. And I wanted to connect with the painter who did it 200 years ago. I even went to see the original in Banaras Hindu University Museum and fought with them that they haven't documented their collection in a book form, so that people don't have to physically visit. And you know, you can, they have such a marvelous collection, and that's the problem with a lot of our museums. I think 99% museums, that they don't document their collection. So this is from Dr. Goswami's book, The Beautiful Sony. And I've used the same posture deliberately and abstracted the body a little, as I did here. Love Beyond Measure. Also, the scales give the linear duality to the organic figure. This is a 14-foot diptych. And on the right hand, you'll see Bombay, because films have been made on her. And of course, there are folk songs. When I was a child, Kande Utte Mair Maave, Main Kadun Di Khadi, Surinder Kaur. So this diptych I love. 14 by 6 feet, Soni Maiwal. The pot also is a metaphor for the body. And out of all the love stories of Punjab, I chose this because I could paint water. This is, of course, the famous story of when he cuts his thigh, when he can't catch fish, and he cuts his thigh so that he can feed it to her. And then she says, okay, from today, you're not coming across the chenab. It's I who will swim to you. When I did the show 15 years back, I wanted everybody to feel like Soni. So I did this river of blue pigment at the entrance of the gallery and had the ghadas cut at angles so that whoever came had to step across that river and become Soni. the symbol of courage who took the plunge. My Buddha's, this one's in Jaipur Museum, it's the tree of suffering from a Godna painting from Bihar, casting a shadow on him. And the shadow of suffering makes the Buddha the Buddha. And it eventually flowers, you know, on the right. Each bar at the bottom, this one's called compassion. Each bar has elements in my lifetime that have had historical importance, like Hiroshima, 1984, 1947, 2002. So these are all written on these bars. And even 2611, pool of blood, that's at the bottom. And this was in Kathmandu, where, you know, by that time I was a little less adventurous post-bypass. So I did the mural on tiles. Harinder and I did it together in my studio. And this is a big wall. You know, sometimes you get rewards for, without expecting them, phalki chamatkar, and it happens. So when I did the Delhi mural, one of the Lady Irwin school girls had become a very powerful IFS officer. And she said, you did this mural for our school, and now we have a new building in Kathmandu. We can only pay you this certain amount that you would get for a little oil painting. But will you come and see the wall? Because it has a very dangerous curve on top. So we have to be very exact with the tiles. So I said, okay, we both went to see the wall. And it was a very, very busy area of Kathmandu, Tamil, where thousands of cars and people pass. So I did this Buddha surrounded by all the local traffic of Kathmandu, which Harinder very diligently drew. And I made this Buddha with all these elements of, you know, flowers and lotuses and other things within him that he's trying to preserve in the middle of this growing chaos. My Nanak, again a bad reproduction, this one's National Gallery, Delhi. Sultanpur Lodi is where we go roughly every year or 2 years, where it all began, the journey where he stepped in as a man and came up as Nanak. And the famous roti nachorna of Malik Bhago and Bhai Lalo. Now, contemporary painters' challenge is that, you know, people are so familiar with the calendar images and, you know, you want to do it a little differently. And for me, the streams of blood and milk were more important. So I had to have this huge space underneath to highlight the streams. This is the miniature in our collection of Bhai Lalo. Mardana's death, I imagined Nanak ji consigning his rabab to the flames after his death. And the Mecca episode where he says, put my feet where Allah is not. And these are all 6 feet canvases. And this is an illustration for a book of Mala Dayal, Nanak the Guru, which she did for children. And this is a penguin book that Kushwant Singh uncle did, Hymns of the Sikh Gurus. This is the 9th Guru whose martyrdom was, you know, yesterday, and Ram Gayo, Ravan Gayo, Jako, Bo Parwar. So I thought I must include this, but Penguin said no death in the book. So I said it's a reality, and whenever any Sikh dies, we recite these hymns. So I had my way, and the painting therefore was included in that. This is the one and only story I wrote in my life 25 years back, because I'm so allergic to watches, and I was telling everybody here, I'm so nervous in front of this laptop also, because computer illiteracy is another major hurdle. So this story is the man who always wore a watch. And it's about how we are so bound by time that, you know, everything, going to school, these are illustrations about 25, I've chosen some for you. He loses his girlfriend because he's late, loses his job because he's late. Then he throws the watch into the Sukna Lake, and then he starts looking at nature, but by then it's too late, he's old. And well, the end is not bad, because he turns into a child once more, soaked in the rain of love, and that's another story. That this is the yogi. You know, some images you don't know why that's happened. A lot of people ask me, why is the thread there? Why is he holding on to the thread? And I always say, I don't know. I wanted him to still be holding a thread. And as he's running away from everything and bursting into color, and there's those 2 feet of the goddess, you know, on the side, he's still holding a thread. But why? And a yogini, another yogini, and that's real fabric around a bending time, because we try to bend time even through art, and you'll recognize Dali's clock. I'm showing even my failed paintings because they're part of my journey. That's Yogini also, and the weapons on the left, and she's standing on a sword. Khande di tar, you know. This, when, for instance, Harinder had to cut his hair when the mobs came in 84. And then I was doing a series thinking of that, you know, Flaming City it's called, and the man is cutting his hair. And having done this image, we went to Alchi about more than 20 years ago, and the first thing I see when I enter Alchi is the fresco in similar colors of the Buddha, similar posture, cutting his head with a sword. I mean, these are amazing things that sometimes happen. Having done the image, I see that image. And so I redid it now, 20 years later, when it was the 30th anniversary of the 1984. My etchings, done about 20 years ago, I've done about 30, 35 etchings. Because the zinc plate has its own surprises. You know, painting is direct, so is working on paper. But sometimes you want to really fight with the medium, and that's the zinc plate. This one's boundaries. It's a map of the world when we are saying, ye mera, ye tera, and the troubles begin. These are all etchings. Series of works on environment. These are kind of posters. We had a 4-person show, and this traveled around schools and colleges. Are we really going forward? You know, that was the whole theme of the show, environment. And these are dharti again, paperwork. Explosion after my great survival, the triple bypass. I did this, more time please, it's called. And we are like this. Works on paper. 15th August, I was so upset. Janda uncha rahe hamara. And you can see all these pathetic figures at the bottom. Chamchagiri, which we are very good at. Works on paper, these are. And this was when the forest was cut before the Commonwealth Games. It's a 6-foot sculpture, 150 kg cast. And it was in the first art fair, and it was called Commonwealth Faith. Because the shattering of faith, there's a crack in that sculpture. And because I'm a painter, my sculptures are flat. It's like a cosmic dance, and the side view. And there are gungrus at the bottom. The famous Jain figure with the inverted kalpavriksh welded, you know, from the head, and the same scissor. It's a 5-foot sculpture. This is a very new work. It's a diptych. Love hurts, love lifts. And there's a little Sufi dancer you can see there. Charkha. They were trying to raise money for a Gandhi statue in London, so this is the painting I'd given. Again, when the forest was cut, you know, I stuck this mirror, and when you hang the painting, it's you can see yourself in the mirror and say, why do I blame anybody else? It's me who's to blame. And ironically, this was included in a show at the time of the Commonwealth Games in Lalit Kala Academy. They hung it in some unknown corner because it was so blatant. This is an installation done in Chennai 2 years back. Painting is not dead. I'll go a little forward. I did a very long table. Got a very long table and spread a canvas roll on it and had drips on each side. And the drip I'm very familiar with, so I'll love to use it here. And from the syringe comes, because there's a lot of new medium, digital, etc. these days, and I'm completely at a loss there. So I wanted to avenge my painting and call it Painting is Not Dead. So from each tip is a blob of color, like this. And you can see the Netaji figure inside. I found these little figures of Netaji, Bhagat Singh ji, Gandhi ji, and I put them in the syringe, you know, like they are giving life to us. And the installation had, it was in a darkened room. There was a blackboard at the back. So whoever came drew on the blackboard. So it was an interactive installation. It was inaugurated by Gopal Gandhi, who made a thread and a needle. on it because of my needle paintings, thread paintings. That's a closer view of it. And this was done, Hussein Saab's death happened, as you know, in forced exile. So it's called Doga Zameen Bhina Mili, and it's done at the entrance of Lalit Kala Academy. It's an underground installation, a 7 by 3 foot mazar. And I had them dig, they let me dig, fortunately, 2 feet below the ground or 3 feet. And an abstract, I didn't dare do a proper flag. So it's an abstract flag of our nation with Hussein Saab's portrait in the middle instead of the wheel. And his favorite motif, the lantern, I had bulbs fixed in that, and at each corner of the flag was a lantern. So 4 lanterns illuminating the underground installation, covered with a fiberglass sheet, and these wooden sticks and a thread, and there was a basket of rose petals. And his son Shamshad, who we lost recently, a very dear friend, he came and strewed the first, you know, rose petal, and then all the visitors, it was there for a month. So whoever came, and I would go every 3-4 days to change the rose petal. So this is Doga Zameen Bhina Mili. I think that's the end. Thank you. I hope I have not... Okay. I think having no sense of time or a watch, I have no idea if I exceeded the 1 hour allotted.
Any questions for the artist? Everybody seems to be in a reflective rather than a questioning mood. Someone there?
And it's an ordeal, so I shifted myself here, sorry. The Shri Yantra I've used as a element of constant or eternal against the flux of time. So I like the form also very much. And as I said, you know, because my everything is so angular, organic, sometimes the angular helps create the duality. But thematically, visually, that's the cause. And thematically, it's the eternal for me. Yeah.
Then may I invite Mr. Sarabjit Singh, our chief guest, to please speak a few words.
Yeah, good evening, everybody. Dr. B.N. Chakravarti. Sorry. Yeah, sorry. Pardon for that. Mr. Guldar Singh Sandhu. Of course, Mrs. Arpana Kaur. Now, I was just wondering that after such an invigorating presentation, a visual delight, a thought-provoking and deeply churning visuals, what could one say? Of course, as somebody just remarked that if I were to put it in my words, that an artist is someone who has one leg in this world and one leg in the other world, or one eye here or the other eye there. A saint is somebody who has maybe both the legs off ground, and people like us, we have to keep both our legs on ground. Otherwise, people will not appreciate the actions. Yeah, and I won't take much time, but I would like to say that about the scissors thing, which ma'am has been in places in her paintings. It was only 2-3 days back, somebody was sitting with me, and I actually, sort of a premonition, you may say, I commented him that we are all like scissors. No, I'm telling you the truth, this actually happened. So he said, how is it? So I said that we have a left brain and a right brain, and you have what you call the third eye. And so these are the scissors, here you basically cut the so-called reality and step into the spiritual world or whatever, and every day you see a new layer of this thing, and that is how day and night pass. So, yeah. So I think that beauty of art is that everybody gets a different message from it, as opposed to science, which is very, very stark, and you can't draw two meanings out of it. Either you understand science or you don't understand it. But art is more kind and more generous. Even a fifth standard student can see some beauty in it. A 10th standard student, an MA pass, a PhD, a saint, a spiritual person, whosoever he is, he will see a different aspect of it. So that's all I have to say. I would say we are all delighted and thankful that we got this opportunity to see ma'am some of the works. And we do hope that Lalit Kala Academy will organize more such events and enrich the citizens with this. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. We now await Professor Goswami's reflections. Sir, please.
जब अर्पणा ने अपनी तस्वीरें दिखाई तो उसमें एक कैप्शन था बिटवीन डुअलिटीज थोड़ा कमजोर कैप्शन है बिटवीन क्वाड्रेलिटीज आई थिंक माइट हैव बीन नाइस बिकॉज शी मूव्स फ्रॉम वन वर्ल्ड टू द अदर विद एक्स्ट्रॉर्डिनरी ईज देयर इज अ सीमलेस कनेक्शन और कनेक्शन क्या है मैं जो समझता हूँ जो टू द एक्सटेंट दैट आई हैव नोन अर्पणा हर वर्क दैट इज ऑफ एम्पथी संस्कृत में शब्द आता है सहृदय जिसका हृदय वैसा ही है जैसा कि बनाने वाले का है तो आमतौर पे उसको कहते हैं सहृदय जो पहचानने वाला होता लेकिन शीत है सहृदय पर्सन क्योंकि आप शुरू से देखिए किस किस्म की चीज़ें उसको मूव करती हैं जो वृंदावन की जो वीडियोज़ की उसने डिस्क्रिप्शन है नहीं आज मैंने वो सितारा सरे मिजगा देखा पोइट कहता है मिजगा कहके अपनी आई लैशेज को आज मैंने वो सितारा सरे मिजगा देखा जो किसी और के गम से भी दमक उठता है तो देर इज़ अ काइंड ऑफ अ क्वालिटी ऑफ फीलिंग इन हर वर्क Whether she is talking about Kabir or Guru Nanak or the widows of Vrindavan or the burial of Maqbool Fida Hussain and so on and so forth. Aisa hai. And I find it quite moving. Ek cheez aapne notice ki hogi, ki iski koi figure jo hai, even though she is very grounded herself, dono paon bilkul zameen pe jame hue hain, is tarah dekhti hain. लेकिन फिगर्स आर ऑल फ्लोटिंग सारी की सारी फिगर्स जो हैं वेदर इट इज़ वन फिगर कहीं से है कहीं वो ज़मीन के ऊपर पाँव उनके हैं नहीं अगर हैं तो बिल्कुल सरसरी तौर पे हैं एंड दैट सेज समथिंग बिकॉज शी इज़ इन अ मैनर ऑफ स्पीकिंग कॉन्स्टेंटली फ्लोटिंग इन द वर्ल्ड ऑफ आइडियाज एंड हर फिगर्स जो भी चुनती हैं जिस तरीके से चुनती हैं महीन उसमें बात है यानी कबीर जी का जो मशहूर है कि झीनी चदरिया राइट जो चादर है वो बहुत महीन बुनी जाती है और आर्टिस्ट के दिमाग में जो चादर है वो बहुत महीन होती है बहुत ही महीन कुछ ही दिन पहले मेरे एक दोस्त आए थे विदेश से उन्होंने कहा कि मैंने एक न्यूयॉर्क में एक ड्रेस देखी तो वो ड्रेस जो थी बड़ी बारीक कपड़े की बनी हुई थी तो लिखा था जैपनीज़ खादी तो मैं हैरान हो गया कि जैपनीज़ खादी क्या चीज़ होती तो वाकई खादी तो हिंदुस्तान से गई थी लेकिन जैपनीज़ ड्रेस उसकी बनाई किसी ने तो जैपनीज़ खादी उसका नाम रखती है तो मैंने कहा ठहरो ये मैं आपको इंडियन खादी दिखवाता हूँ आई स्पोक टू सामबडी इन अहमदाबाद जो मेरे दोस्त थे उन्होंने खादी मंदिर वहाँ पर है तो खादी भेजी यानी कि इतनी महीन उसके नीचे हाथ रखिए तो पूरी उंगलियां दिखती थी इस तरह करके तो फैंटास्टिक द स्किल्स हैव नॉट बीन लॉस्ट लेकिन मैं सूक्ष्मता की बात कर रहा हूँ महीन बात कर रहा हूँ जो है यानी कि ये महीन तरीके से देखना बहुत ही महीन तरीके से उसको महसूस करना महीन तरीके से उसको ढालना विजुअल इमेज के अंदर कम लोगों में है बहुत बरस पहले मैं इंडिया इंटरनेशनल सेंटर में सीढ़ियाँ चढ़ रहा था तो वहाँ एक बड़ा पोस्टर लगा था अर्पणा का बना हुआ वो यूनेस्को के लिए यूनिसेफ के लिए आपने बनाया था वीमन बेयर मोर देन हाफ द वेट ऑफ द वर्ल्ड ऐसे करके और झुकी हुई है और पीठ के ऊपर एक दुनिया का ऐसे इफ आई रिमेंबर इट करेक्टली ब्यूटिफुल मीनिंगफुल एंड एट द सेम टाइम विजुअली डिमांडिंग विजुअली चैलेंजिंग एंड विजुअली सेटिस्फाइंग कहने का मुद्दा ये है कि अर्पणा एक स्पंज की तरह है इसका काम महसूस करती है सोक करती है आइडियाज यहाँ से वहाँ से ऐसे करके एंड शी मेक्स नो बोन्स अबाउट इट अब मिनिएचर्स की बात करती हैं तो बार बार यानी कि मेरे से कई बार बात होती है या हुई है और अब बार बार जिक्र किया है इन्होंने कि ये फला मिनिएचर ऐसे करके है पहाड़ जो हैं सीधे भी हैं उल्टे भी हैं इधर से भी देखे जा सकते हैं पानी का रंग ये हो सकता है कहीं पर साल्वाडोर डाली का है कहीं पर शगाल की तरह फिगर्स फ्लोट कर रही हैं इस तरह कर कर लेकिन क्या है इसमें कोई किसी किस्म का छिपाव नहीं है एक असर्शन है कि आई कैन टेक एनी थिंग फ्रॉम एनी वेयर विच इज़ अ साइन ऑफ अ ग्रेट आर्टिस्ट ए ग्रेट आर्टिस्ट ये कोई कुमार स्वामी ने बड़ी अच्छी बात कही थी वी कैन ओनली एंटरटेन आइडियाज वी कांट क्रिएट आइडियाज आइडिया सब क्रिएट हो चुके हैं वी कैन ओनली एंटरटेन आइडियाज तो मैं ख़त्म करता हूँ बात सरजीत जी आए हैं मैं इनसे ज़रा थोड़ी लंबी बात कर रहा हूँ इसलिए माफ़ी चाहता हूँ लेकिन भागवत पुराण में एक जगह पे जिक्र आता है कि किसी कोई मिलते हैं किसी को अवधूत को अवधूत होते हैं जो दुनिया से बेगाना है तो अवधूत से पूछते हैं वो कोई आदमी कि आपके गुरु कौन है आप पहुंचे हुए आदमी आपके गुरु कौन है वो कहते हैं मेरे 16 गुरु हैं तो देन ही स्टार्ट्स नेमिंग गुरु जो है नाम इंसान नहीं है कोई मैंने क्या क्या सीखा है किससे मैंने बी से ये सीखा है फूल से ये सीखा है राइट दुश्मन से ये सीखा है और जो सच बोलने वाले उनसे ये सीखा है 16 ऑब्जेक्ट्स नेम्स ऑफ थिंग्स और पीपल एट्सेट्रा ही टेक्स ये मेरे गुरु हैं ये है यू टेक फ्रॉम एनी वेयर दैट यू लाइक वट एवर यू कैन इंटरनलाइज वट एवर यू कैन रियली इन अ सर्टन सेंस मास्टर और उससे निकलता है सब कुछ आई एम डिलाइटेड कि अर्पणा ने अपना काम दिखाया शेयर किया नॉट ओनली दैट बट वॉट इंस्पायर्ड हर टू डू दैट वही बात है तो मैंने वो सितारा सरे मिजगां देखा जो किसी और के गम से भी दमक उठता है और वक्त की जो पहचान है ये वक्त में घुसना वक्त में दाखिल होना हमारे देश में जो वक्त की जो टाइम का जो कॉन्सेप्ट है बिल्कुल डिफरेंट है हमारे कल्चर में टाइम लीनियर नहीं है टाइम सर्कुलर भी है टाइम डायगनल पे भी जाता है टाइम कम्स बैक टू इट सेल्फ एंड सो ऑन मैं बहुत लेक्चर ले टाइम के ऊपर नहीं देना चाहता लेकिन वक्त जो है चमकीले सांप की मानिंद यूँ फिसलता सा निकल जाता है कि मुझे कुछ यकीन नहीं होता ये सरकना जो वक्त का है उसको समझना उसको महसूस करना और उससे मिस्टिफाइड रहना हर एक का हिस्सा नहीं है जिसका है उसको मुबारक थैंक यू वेरी मच
थैंक यू सर फॉर योर सेंसिटिव एंड पोएटिक आर्टिकुलेशन आई एम श्योर ऑल ऑफ अस इन द ऑडियंस लुक फॉरवर्ड टू योर ऑब्जर्वेशंस एवरी टाइम एंड नाउ इट्स टाइम टू ask the person who's been instrumental in getting all this together, our chairman, Mr. Bhim Malhotra, to please address you all.
तो सबसे पहले तो मैं आपसे माफ़ी चाहता हूँ कि थोड़ा प्रोग्राम आज लेट स्टार्ट हुआ और दूसरा आप सब का मैं दिल से स्वागत करता हूँ एंड थैंक्स फील करता हूँ कि आप सब इतनी तादाद में ये प्रोग्राम देखने आए और स्पेशली थैंक्स अर्पना कौर जी का जो दिल्ली से आए, जहाँ तक मैं कहूँ कि जब से मैंने आर्ट फील्ड में, या हम सब ने जो हमारी एज ग्रुप में आर्ट फील्ड में होश संभाला है, तो हम इनका नाम सुन रहे हैं, तो इनका काम, इनकी प्रेजेंटेशन तो फर्स्ट टाइम देखी है। तो मैं चंडीगढ़ ललित कला एकेडमी से और शहर के जितने आर्ट लवर हैं सब की तरफ से अर्पना जी, मैं आपका बहुत थैंक्स करता हूँ। और अर्पना जी के बारे में मैं आपको दो चार चीज़ें और बताना चाहूँगा, जैसे मैंने इनसे थोड़ी बहुत बात की या इनके बारे में मैं दूसरों से जाना। आर्ट तो ये अच्छा करते ही करते हैं, शी इज़ वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग, इनकी आज जो पेंटर जर्नी हमने देखी। तो एज ए ह्यूमन बींग, एज ए जो गरीब लोगों की जितनी हेल्प करते हैं और सोशल वर्क कितना करते हैं, कितना डोनेशन करते हैं, मेरे ख्याल से दिस इज़ वंडरफुल थिंग फॉर एन आर्टिस्ट। और जो इनमें सेंसिटिविटी है, वो कहता है आर्ट इज द सेलिब्रेशन ऑफ सेंसिटिविटीज, तो आज हमने सारा सेंसिटिविटीज का सेलिब्रेशन इनके काम में देखा है। और वैसे ही सेंसिटिविटी मैंने इनमें देखी है, जो भी मेरी थोड़ी बहुत इनसे बात हुई है। तो मेरे ख्याल से हर एक आर्टिस्ट के लिए ये सब चीज़ें होना बड़ा ज़रूरी है। आर्टिस्ट तो चलो बाद में है, तो गुड ह्यूमन बींग होना उससे पहले है, मतलब कि। तो दीज आर वेरी गुड थिंग्स, तो शी इज़ कम्प्लीट आर्टिस्ट जो मैंने इनको देखा है। तो आई फील मैनी थैंक्स फ्रॉम द बिहाफ ऑफ द सिटीजन ऑफ चंडीगढ़, एंड आई ऑल्सो फील थैंक्स अवर फाइनेंस सेक्रेटरी सरबजीत सिंह जी, जिन्होंने टाइम निकाला। और सरबजीत सिंह जी भी, उनको आपने सुना होगा, ही इज ऑल्सो ग्रेट आर्ट लवर और बड़े आर्टिस्टिक टेस्ट के हैं, और आर्ट और आर्टिस्ट दोनों को समझते हैं। आर्टिस्ट को समझना भी एक बड़ी बात होती है। और मैं बीएन गोस्वामी जी का भी बड़ा थैंक्स करता हूँ कि हर बार हमारे इतने प्रेजेंटेशन में आके चार चांद लगाते हैं, एंड वी फील ओनर, ही इज़ द गोल्डन प्रॉपर्टी ऑफ द सिटी। और एंड और शहर के काफ़ी जाने मानी हस्तियाँ बैठी हैं शहर में, मैं उनका भी स्वागत करता हूँ। और मेरे काफ़ी हो गया, थैंक यू वेरी मच।
आई रिक्वेस्ट यू सर टू प्लीज प्रेजेंट मेमेंटो टू Mr. Sarabjit Singh, a memento of gratitude, some memorabilia from the Lalit Kala Academy, also to Ma'am Arpana Kaur.
Can I say one word? The chief guest who said he has both his legs on the ground and no leg in the air, unlike us, has just given me his poem on scissor, and I'd like to read two lines which are very beautiful. In dream space, another there is not space with space does dreams trace. It's a long poem and I'm really surprised, so both legs are not on the ground.
And also to Ma'am Arpana Kaur, a memento. And for Professor B.N. Goswami.